can we vamp with here?
No.
Now?
Yeah.
Can I have a G, please? That threw me off. Oh, you know what? I need an F, not a G, sorry. Thank you. Not yet. Not till after the blessing of the palms. You haven't got it. Yep. Got it. Thank you. So I'll cue you, Arcady, but you got a few minutes. So we're beginning on page 3 of your leaflet. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, O Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts whereby you have given us life and immortality, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately.' They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that had been cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest.' Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for the acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. On this day, he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed as King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palm along his way. Let these branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King, in glory with you and the Father, the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Let us go forth in peace.
In the name
Could I have some help handing out the branches? Please. Paul.
Oh, glory, Lord, and honor to the Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children make sweet hosannas ring.
Okay, let's head towards the door.
Love Israel, thou dare.
Blessed is the King who comes. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not up to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Open unto us the gates of Jerusalem.
Good morning and welcome to All Saints. Whether you are gathered here in the pews or whether you are gathered around a screen, we are strengthened and enriched by your worship on this Palm Sunday. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in your tender love for the human race, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering
and also share in his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, have I set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the Epistle of Paul to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Sequence in this morning is right on in majesty, and I would invite the readers of the Passion narrative to come forward during the singing of the hymn. To our cast, when you're reading your line, please get close to a microphone so that the folks at home can hear you. You can bring it close. Why don't you make like you like each other and come closer. Close up that circle. A lot of stage directions for Palm Sunday. And the congregation may be seated until the point at which Golgotha is mentioned. You'll know when to stand up, because there's a little cross in there, or I'll give you one of these. I invite you just to take a breath. And your part is Mark Crowd. Hear the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread.
The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
"Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people."
While he was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, he sat at the table. A woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard, and she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger, and they scolded her. But Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the world, and what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him his money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. And on the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, the disciples said to Jesus,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples ahead, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asked, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there."
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them. And they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, Jesus came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and to say to him one after another,
"Surely not I."
Jesus said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said,
"Take, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all become deserters, I will not."
Jesus said to him,
"Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But Peter said vehemently,
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated and said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
"Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want."
Jesus came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, Are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy. And they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough! The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Immediately, when he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard.
So when he came, he went up to him at once and said,
Rabbi,
and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. And then Jesus said to them,
Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled.
All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, But even on this point, their testimonies did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?
But Jesus was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him and to blindfold him and to strike him, saying to him,
Prophesy!
The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, But he denied it, saying,
I do not know or understand what you are talking about.
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
This man is one of them.
But again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
Certainly.
But he began to curse and swore an oath.
I do not know this man you are talking about.
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said to him, Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times. And Peter broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and the scribes and the whole cohort. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you."
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, at the festival, he used to release for them a prisoner, anyone for whom they asked. Now, a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels, a man who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do it for them according to his custom. And then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again,
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him!"
Pilate asked him,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted at him all the more,
"Crucify him!"
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him to the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began to salute him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
Then they struck his head with a reed and spat upon him and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put on his own clothes. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. And then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha. Which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them,
casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him.
The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him, they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Ah, you who destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 o'clock. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
"My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"Listen, he's calling for Elijah."
And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down."
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion, who stood facing him, saw that in this way he breathed his last, the centurion said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, the younger, and of Joses, and of Salome. They used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee, and there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus.
Then Pilate
wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph brought a linen cloth and, taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I always find it challenging to preach on Palm Sunday because the day pretty much preaches itself. If we paid attention to what we have just done, we've gone from blessing the palms that were tossed in front of Jesus as a carpet, as sort of a red carpet, to the place where we have shouted, "Crucify." And when I say we, it's something that's called anamnesis, and that is sort of a living, active memory. We may not have actually done it ourselves, but we are living into that memory, and it's a memory that transforms us. It's a memory that we can hold in the palm of our hands, essentially. But we have to hold it more than just on Palm Sunday. We have to hold it in our hearts as well. And I think that we also hold it in our bodies. You know, there's something called muscle memory. Do you know what happened? You know, if you're driving, how much attention are you actually paying to what you're doing with the gas pedal? You know, probably not very much, which is why people have parking speeding tickets. But we know that we just have to put our foot down on the gas pedal to make it go. And we just do it normally. And if you drive a manual transmission, you know that you're going to just push in the clutch and shift gears, and you almost don't think about it. You become practically the automatic transmission. Or when you're riding a bicycle, there's a reason you don't forget riding how to ride a bicycle. It's because it's a muscle memory. It's something that happens just by itself, almost. And so I've been thinking about that a lot as we are walking into Holy Week, and I believe that if we do it right, then what happens during Holy Week becomes a muscle memory as well. It's something that we keep in our hearts, yes, and in our minds, but I think we also hold it in our bodies. Think about the times that you have been through the week, through the Holy Week services, here or elsewhere. We begin today, of course, with the most complicated Sunday of the year. It's the only Sunday of the year that we have a parade and a play at the same time. And we walk through the story of Jesus's passion. We really move forward in time. And that's good. But then on Tuesday in Holy Week, we have a service that's called Tenebrae. And that is the service of shadows. That's what the word tenebrae means. And the shadows lengthen as we snuff the candles on what's called a tenebrae hearse. That's the triangular candle stand. And when we do that, it becomes darker and darker in the church. The shadows are falling upon us. And we read many of the Psalms, including Psalm 22, which begins, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And so we are invited into that place that Jesus was in. And he knows the Psalms. They're part of him. They're part of his heart memory. They're part of his muscle memory. And so we walk into that. And then on the Wednesday in Holy Week, we have just a very brief healing service. And that we ask that God would drive far from us any sickness, any dis-ease. I always pronounce it that way. Not just disease, but dis-ease of body, mind, or spirit. And then, of course, on Maundy Thursday, we again walk through the most important event, or one of the most important events of Holy Week, the establishment of the Last Supper. Jesus is together with the 12 and others, probably, who are helping him to mark the Passover. And as we do that, we start with a supper. We used to start with just a soup supper, and it was really sort of dismal, right? Good soup usually, but still. And it occurred to me, why are we doing that? Jesus was having a Passover feast with his disciples, so why are we having, you know, essentially just the minimum? It's not really what makes sense. And so now we do a potluck dinner. See how I worked in that announcement? And then Good Friday, we're together as a family, as a parish family, and we walk again the story as we build the Easter garden and as we literally walk through the stations of the cross. And I think as we do that out in the big wide world of Bayside, it's even more meaningful than when we used to just do it here inside the church. And then on Holy Saturday, the most important, or perhaps the most important service of the year, which entirely too few of you come to, by the way, the great vigil of Easter. We bless the candle that is the symbol of Easter. We retrace salvation history. We have wonderful hymns. We have wonderful readings. We have a very short sermon. And then we break our Easter fast. We can have our Lenten fast. We have chocolate. We have champagne, whatever, afterwards. But there our bodies are released from the stringencies that we have placed upon them in Lent. And then, of course, Easter Day, we celebrate all that has gone before. But I invite you to walk through with intentionality this Holy Week, to be here a lot. And if you can't be here, to log on a lot. Everything will be live streamed except the Wednesday afternoon service. And I invite you to make a muscle memory, to be able to just do it without even thinking. I invite you to a place where you can be transformed without even paying attention really to what you were doing, but to knowing that when you are transformed and when you have come to this place of the cross, that we were in fact there when we crucified our Lord. We were in fact there. And if it didn't cause us to tremble, tremble, tremble. Something might be just a little bit off. So walk with me, with your parish family, this Holy Week. Celebrate the gifts of God. We have to get there first. We have to go through the difficult stories. But we know, as Jesus knew, take this cup away from me.
Do I have to do this way? We know, as the disciples didn't, what comes at the end. Let this time be transformational. Let it become part of you spiritually, emotionally, and yes, physically. Amen. Now let us stand and affirm our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. Page 7. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
And that we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, remembering especially Sade, Kristen and her caregivers, Mike, John, and Eddie.
Ryan. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign now and forever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning. Good to be with you all on this Palm Sunday, always the most complicated Sunday of the year. I've got one more complication for you, which we'll get to last, so we remember. But our a few announcements. First and foremost, our liturgical gifts, the palms are given by Paul and Susan Parfrey to the glory of God and in loving memory of Carolyn Tisar.
And the bread and the wine of the Eucharist are given by our family in to the glory of God and in loving memory of my mother, Beatrice Byrne. Easter flower memorials. If you haven't turned in your little red envelope yet, please do so. Our registrar, I guess, is Carol Crow or and or Stella, so you can give them directly to them, or you can put them in the offering plate. And if you're saying, I didn't bring it with me, we have more in the back. So, but we need those by Tuesday because Easter is almost upon us, and Stella has blessedly agreed once again to compile that list, and she needs time to do that. I'll let Susan talk about the Good Friday retreat. We're doing pretty well on Easter treats, but we can always use a few more and a few more of the plastic eggs as well, I think. So please bring those anytime up this week up until Friday morning. And our Easter coffee hour. Easter is the great feast day of the year, and your vestry has something planned, but we could use a little help if you'd like to bring some baked goods or some et cetera. Please speak to Judy or to Francesca about that, or just turn up. I snuck in the announcement about the Agape dinner on Maundy Thursday, but I hope that we will have a good turnout for that, and that there's kind of meager sign up on the bulletin board at the moment. So please sign up and do plan to bring that. We were at St. John's for their Lenten program, 30 pieces of silver on Friday evening. And I kid you not, the buffet was the length of one of our pews. So just about, right?
Oh, longer.
So we can't get shown up because once again coming to join us for Maundy Thursday. Altar Guild, number one, thank you so much to everyone who made the church beautiful today, and to Iris and to Megan, who made the palm crosses for us and who I disappointed by remembering how to do it. But next Saturday, we're going to be working on making making the church beautiful for Easter as well. So that'll be next Sunday at 10, we're going to be doing something else. Saturday at 9, sorry. Okay. I think I'm going to be quiet now. Susan. Oh, yes, we'll get to that in a no, I'll do it now. We have the Diocesan Altar Guild is sponsoring a trip to the Cathedral Church of St. John the Divine on Saturday, April 13th. If you've been to St. John the Divine, then you know how beautiful it is. If you haven't been there in a while, then you don't know how beautiful it is. Every time one goes, it's something slightly different. I haven't been in years, so I'm really looking forward to this. Sally is our registrar, and there are sign-up forms in the sacristy. So if you have any further questions about that, talk to Sally. She knows all there is to know about it. So, and by the way, you do not have to be Altar Guild. We're expecting people who are just members or friends or, you know, bring a friend or six. We have a 56-passenger bus to fill up, and the Diocesan Altar Guild budget can't afford to take that kind of hit. So please... So please do bring people. You will be glad you came. Susan.
Morning. This is going to be a really busy week. I know last week was a busy week, but this is really busy week, guys, because we have Palm Sunday banners to make in the church schoolroom. So we're going to do that. But even before we get to start those, we're going to be here in the church practicing our special Easter song, okay? So we want to start that right away so that we have plenty of time to work on our banners. Then on Friday at 9 o'clock, our special Good Friday retreat, which is for everyone. And we really need everyone. We need as many of you as possible to come and help us make our big Easter garden in the hallway that tells the whole story of the Passion. It's an event that requires the smallest child and the tallest adult, for sure. So please mark your calendars for that. And then afterwards, we will be doing our Stations of the Cross, hopefully out in the streets of Bayside, weather permitting. So we have a lot to go on to do. And then, of course, we can't forget the really big day next Sunday, Easter Sunday, when we will be having our famous Easter egg hunt. And if you would like to help the Easter Bunny on that morning, please talk to Jack Osher, because he's a very good friend, I've heard. A very good friend of the Easter Bunny. In fact, the Easter Bunny taught Jack how to hop. So if you ask him, maybe he'll show you. So anyway, we would love to have you help him. And yes, please, we're still taking contributions of candy, plastic eggs, and anything else that we could use for the hunt. So thank you very much. And bring your Easter baskets, please.
Yeah, we have a few, but bring them.
Bring your Easter
baskets. And I see Arcady's on the on-deck circle.
Good morning. Happy Palm Sunday. My speech will be very short. About 1 month ago, I had a short speech in front of you to ask anybody to help us to raise our choir. You see, today is the first day of Holy Week, and we have a new members.
Yes, sincere thanks to the guy that we often refer to as our secret weapon, Artie Chenault, and also to Brooke Xavier for being with us this morning. And hopefully we'll have them here again next Sunday. And here's the one last thing that I said I was going to announce, and that is it's been a while since we've had an offertory anthem. So we need an offertory anthem and an offertory hymn this morning. So ushers and acolytes, this is for you. During the singing of the hymn, which is number 150, it's in your hymnal. That's the book in front of you, if you remember those things, the bigger one. Hymn number 150, we'll be singing that as we receive the offering and as we set the altar, and then the choir will do the offertory anthem following the hymn. So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Accept and use these gifts, O Lord, as may be best for your church. All things come of thee, O Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For our sins, he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself, and by his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us, with all your saints, into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Amen. Jump to the God. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
We invite all those joining us remotely today to join in this act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you physically, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you are already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray together. Eternal God,
Heavenly Father,
you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you through Christ our Lord. Christ our Lord. Amen.
Bow down before the Lord.
Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this, your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you for coming. Thank you for singing lustily. And thank you new for bringing the peace that only God has given you. But before I dismiss you, please put your passion read. Is it passion reading, Father?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, put it to the corner. Put it to the side so that when the others come down to pick up, they can do that. All right? Good. Yes. Yeah. So go in peace, love and serve the Lord. And see you in the common room.
I don't know if you'll hear me or not,
but I want to say a word of thanks to our acolytes because they always do a great job, but it fills me with such joy to see a full complement of acolytes up there, as Teddy has always called it, acolyte-palooza. And so thank you, acolytes. I hope you hear us.